what the fuck is this, dude? I read that this game is only supposed to take about an hour and a half to do, which is insane because the PS2 version took like six. In the Year of the Dragon, in a world beyond the realms, I, like all the others, the game's bugging out. Oh my god, look at that sprite of Sparks, dude, he still looks like shit. Come on, mom said we have to hurry. The bulb spiders are wrecking her mushroom patch. Oh boy. Whack-a-bulb spider. Hit each spider as it pops up from the ground. Whack them all within the time limit. Press M. Okay. What the fuck is this? This is the legend of Spyro. Oh shit! He just gets caught. Hold the R to use fire breath. What the hell is this? And that's it. I like how there's no fucking like animation. It's just he just stands there and just fire. End of the line. Wow, we even have to do the platforming shit. Get fucked. My time. An hour and a half. Look at that. An hour and a half. That's it. That's all this game takes. Hello everyone and welcome back to our deep dive into the Spyro the Dragon universe. In the last video, we kicked off this deep dive with looking at the Legend of Spyro trilogy. A trilogy intended to reboot the franchise. And the first game in that trilogy was A New Beginning, and it was hot trash. Even after making the review for that game and letting it all digest over this past few weeks, I still cannot find any redeeming quality for that game. Today we will continue with looking at the sequel to A New Beginning, The Legend of Spyro, The Eternal Night. The Eternal Night came out October 2nd of 2007, less than 1 year after the release of the first one. And to give you an idea of what else came out in 2007, for video games, we got Super Mario Galaxy, the first BioShock, Halo 3, Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare, and the first Uncharted. Yet another legendary year for video games. And we got a new Spyro game. And in film, we got There Will Be Blood, No Country for Old Men, Michael Clayton, and the host from ya boy, Bong Joon-ho. Eternal Night was written and directed by Chris A. Wilson, who did nothing else before this game. Another one of the writers was Michael Graham, who, again, nothing before this. A third writer was Patrick Hegarty, who was the writer for A New Beginning. So, as you can see, we have a very, very not good staff working on this game. Eternal Night and A New Beginning as well were both developed by Chrome Studios, which is also the studio who did the Tie the Tasmanian Tiger series, which I played the first one on the PS2, and I loved that game. There is a version of Eternal Night for the Wii, the PS2, the DS, and once again, the Game Boy Advance. Although, it is kind of weird because the PS3 was released in 2006, so you'd think they'd make a version for that, although this does tell us that this game and A New Beginning were both made probably just, if not at the same time, then just right back to back. But again, I'll just be focusing on the PS2 version because that is the one that I played. So critics responded to the PS2 version actually a little bit worse than A New Beginning. A New Beginning was roughly right down the middle. It was more towards the positive side. But for this, IGN gave Eternal Night a 3.6 out of 10. Metacritic gave it a 54%. Much worse than its predecessor, but still just right down the middle. So in terms of how the critics responded to these games and how I responded to these games, like I was saying, A New Beginning got kind of right down the middle, but it was more towards the positive side. It was kind of like a 6 or a 7 out of 10. But yet I absolutely despised it. But for Eternal Night, critics kind of hated it. But for me, Eternal Night starts shortly after A New Beginning, and Spyro's powers are still suppressed, I guess. We see Spyro following Cinder through the woods. When he catches up, she tells him she wants to leave because she still feels bad for what she did, even though she had absolutely no control over what she did. And now that she is free, she wants to find her own destiny. Spyro begs her not to go, but she goes anyway. And after she leaves, Spyro passes out and has a vision of a tree, and we meet the voice of the Chronicler. Oh, and also in this vision, Spyro relearns his fire breath. And he also learns, and I swear to God this is real, to slow down time. They call it Dragon Time. Very creative. When he wakes up, the Dragon Temple is under attack from the apes. Again. After the fight, we learn the overall premise of this game.
What is it you see in these dreams of yours?
I'm sorry, Ignitus. I thought they would go away. But they only get worse.
Relax, Spyro. Think.
I keep seeing a mountain draped in shadow. A face of stone beneath two moons. And darkness.
The Mountain of Malifor.
There was another, but it was more like I was seeing into the past and the future all at once. And there was a voice calling himself the Chronicler. That's when I saw the tree. Who is the Chronicler?
The Chronicler is an ancient dragon of immeasurable wisdom.
It is true. It is unsettling that the re-emergence of the Chronicler would coincide with an attack on the temple. Not to mention these other visions that Spyro was having.
Yes, very Tales of the Chronicler are often interwoven with tales of doom.
The celestial moons are almost at an eclipse. This we know for certain.
We must prepare for the worst. The night of eternal darkness draws nigh.
The forces of the Ape King know of Spyro's existence and will not rest until they witness his demise.
What should I do, Ignitus?
Young dragon, you must travel by another path and seek out the tree from your dream. If the stories of the Chronicler are true, there may be hope for us yet. And I think I know where to begin.
So Spyro heads off to the ancient grove to search for the tree from his vision. And just randomly, he passes out again and has another vision where he regains his ice breath. And we see the Ape King leading a large group of other apes to the mountain from Spyro's dream. It's actually called the Well of Souls. Spyro wakes up, and after a lot of dumb shit, we find what appears to be the tree. But actually, it's the guardian of the grove. Spyro defeats the tree monster, only to have fucking sky pirates show up and capture him. It turns out, the sky pirates wanted to use the tree monster to fight in their coliseum. But since Spyro defeated it, Spyro gets to fight instead. After the first battle, Spyro randomly passes out again and regains his earth breath. The Chronicler finally tells Spyro where he is, at a place called the Celestial Caves. After another fight, Spyro is given a note from none other than your boy, Hunter of Avalar. You know, this fucking doofus from Spyro 2. So I actually really like that they did this. Like, if I would have played this game when it came out back in 2007, which I would have been like 12, like, I would have lost my fucking shit to see that they put Hunter in these games. Like, that is actually really cool, and I really like that they did that. And we also see that the Sky Pirates have captured, oh my god, the fucking Manwersmalls. Yeah, they're back. Why? So we're still fighting in the Colosseum, by the way. And the final fight Spyro is in is actually against Cinder. We get no context as to how she got here, by the way. So obviously, instead of fighting, they both escape. And this is when the apes attack the Sky Pirates, and they take Cinder hostage. Spyro breaks into the captain's quarters to find a map to the White Isle, where the Celestial Caves are. And after defeating the pirate captain, Spyro has a final vision where he regains the lightning breath. And we also see Cinder before the Ape King at the Well of Souls. Upon arriving to the White Isle and going through a lot more dumb shit, we finally meet the Chronicler, and he gives us every last bit of lore that we need right now.
You've seen this hideous creature before.
Why is he in my book?
It was Gaul who led the raid on the temple the night of your birth.
Oh shit.
Ignitus rescued your egg. Spyro, you must understand, when she was taken by Gaul, she was poisoned and corrupted, made to do the Dark Master's bidding.
Yes, we know.
Her entire life has been spent in
Yes.
Shadow. She knows no other way.
Yes, I know.
And when the Dark Master returns,
it's so obvious.
She will concede. No one can resist what? The temptation.
Satan.
Not even the strongest among us. There was once a dragon, long ago, whose raw power was far greater than anyone had ever seen or could imagine. At first, he mastered fire, which was odd because he was not a fire dragon. Then came ice and wind and other abilities none thought possible. Is this story sounding familiar?
It was a purple dragon, like me.
The first purple dragon. In the beginning, he was encouraged, and secrets of elemental mastery were passed on to him willingly by the elders. But his power was limitless. It knew no boundary. He consumed everything. When he would not stop, he was cast into exile. And from his new fortress within the mountain, he built an armor, not of dragons, but of apes, and taught them to artificially harness the power of the gems, our life force.
You're talking about the Dark Master.
Yes. And in his dark seclusion, the sheer weight of his malice cracked the very foundation of the mountain, splitting the earth, creating a pit of despair where the lost souls of this world could reside.
The Well of Souls.
Created by the very beast who now seeks to escape it.
But you said that the eclipse would only allow the spirits to escape for a short while.
Yes, but if there was ever a spirit powerful enough...
Then how do we stop it?
There is no stopping it. It has been written.
Then why have you called us here? I don't understand.
To ride out this storm, where you'll be safe. Live.
Holy shit, it's Terminator 3. Wow.
All right, this is it. Everything is fucked. Spyro is given a choice to either stay hidden and await Malifor's arrival, or to go and rescue Cinder. Wait a minute, this sounds familiar. Spyro obviously decides to head to the Well of Souls to rescue Cinder, and after a lot more fucking dumb shit, Spyro faces off against the Ape King. During the fight, the moons align and Spyro is filled with the dark energy and is transformed into, oh my god, Dark Spyro. He straight up murders the Ape King, and when the moons pass, the mountain begins to crumble. All of their exits are blocked. Spyro decides to activate his fury power and encases himself, Sparks, and Cinder in, well, I thought it was ice, but according to the wiki, it was a time crystal. Then the game just ends. The post-credit scene, we see your boy, Hunter, watching over the crystallized trio. The end? Nah, man, we got one fucking more of these. The second game in this trilogy is, unfortunately, still really bad. However, let's start with something that I didn't do for A New Beginning, because again, that game has absolutely no redeeming qualities at all. Let's start with some things that I actually liked, or that I thought this game did better than A New Beginning. It's not much, but it's there. It may be because I'm just terrible at this game, but it is actually pretty challenging. I died so many times. Fuck off, dude. What? I can't move, so this is the only thing, this is the only option. Nope. All right, well, we're gonna end it there for today. Go fuck yourself. Apparently, one of the criticisms for the game was that it was too challenging. This is the Dark Souls of Spyro games. Upgrading your abilities actually has a noticeable effect in this game. I could actually tell that my breaths were getting more powerful. And they also don't include, like, the secondary attacks as, like, a separate upgrade bar, which was nice. There are now these dragon-looking things. They don't explain at all what they are, but these things actually increase your maximum health and mana. God, I hate calling it that. These were super nice. Not just because I could increase my maximum health, but it also added the need to explore, which was one of my biggest criticisms for A New Beginning. Finally, I liked that the story was slightly more complex. Not really, but like, mainly that they added a backstory to the Dark Master. Like, imagine if they told us all of this in A New Beginning. It would have made it so much better. The story is still stupid as fuck, but it's better than A New Beginning. All right, that's it. That's all I liked. So now, it's time to get into the fun stuff. This game feels exactly like the first one. And it just furthers my belief that both of these games were made at like the exact same time. And Eternal Night just feels like it could have just been DLC to A New Beginning, which I'll get into that later. The controls are the exact same, except for the addition of Dragon Time. The graphics are the exact same. The gems are still completely pointless. They changed the melee sound effect, but it still sounds like shit. The game is still so goddamn repetitive. Like, there's this one enemy that kinda acts like a mini-boss, and the way that you fight him is the exact same every single time, and it happens like 5 times. And not a single one of those times is it ever enjoyable. So in addition to the dragon head looking things, they also included a bunch of these feathers that are scattered around each level. It's like, why they're feathers? I don't fucking know. But all they do is they unlock art that you can access from the main menu. Who the fuck gives a shit? Like, I'm not gonna go out of my fucking way in a level that's already bullshit enough to get a feather to unlock a piece of art that I'm just gonna look at for 3 seconds and be like, oh yeah, that's cool, and then just move on. There is still so much pointless and tedious bullshit in this game. Like, oh my god, I think this one pissed me off even more than A New Beginning. But before I get into that, so at the end of A New Beginning, Spyro loses all of his powers. But what he didn't lose was the ability to fly. He literally flies away right here. So, I mean, you can see where I'm going with this. So, yeah, Spyro can still fly. And that alone makes all of this fucking retarded. But anyway, so during the pirate ship level, when Spyro is in the Colosseum, doing these 3 fights is not necessary. What they could have done is you do the executioner fight, Spyro loses, but then he regains his earth breath, and then he wins. And then during the next cutscene, they could have done the Man Were Smalls and Hunter's Note, and then Spyro goes out to fight Cinder. These other 2 fights were just completely pointless. And speaking of which, what was the point of having the Man Were Smalls there? Why the Man Were Smalls? Why not
the Atlawa?
Like, there, like, absolutely no reason. So Spyro breaks into the captain's quarters to find a map to the White Isle. However, before he can escape, the captain attacks him. And after the fight, the captain somehow flies away.
How is that even possible?
So, Spyro saw the map before the captain attacked. He has all that he needs. He has no reason to stay. Like, dude, Cinder got captured by the apes. Time is of the essence, you fucking moron. But instead of just leaving, Spyro fucking chases down the captain. And we go through this entire fucking elaborate level to fight him for literally nothing. And why do we have to go ship to ship? Spyro can fly, goddamn it. Fuck. The voice acting is still pretty bad. Gary Oldman is still Ignitus, but he's only in the game for like the first hour. And I honestly don't remember if the other dragons even had any lines. They changed Sparks' voice actor. It's no longer David Spade. It's now Billy West, or as you might know him as Fry from Futurama. But don't worry, he's still super fucking annoying. We get the origin of Sparks eating bugs, but it has nothing to do with anything, and it was just in there for reference to the original trilogy, I guess. I don't know, who fucking cares? The enemies are still trash. The Sky Pirates are the exact same as the apes. They have the exact same moveset. They're just textured differently. But yeah, Sparks is still completely useless and very annoying. And yes, he does continue to make statements referencing things that shouldn't exist in their universe. It's just like the first one.
Low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home.
This game feels super short. Let me just generalize the story a little bit. So Spyro fights off an ape attack at the Dragon Temple. He goes to the Ancient Grove and is abducted by Sky Pirates. Spyro fights through the pirate ships to find the map to the White Isle, which, by the way, this level is so insanely long. Like, it took me like a little over 2 hours just to beat this one level. And it's all because Spyro fucking decides to chase the captain down for absolutely no reason. It adds so much time. Spyro goes to the White Isle to find the Chronicler. He finds him, and then he goes to the Well of Souls to face off against Gaul, the Ape King. And that's it. There's not really much that happens. Unlocking the breaths is, again, super stupid. All that happens is you fall unconscious at extremely inconvenient times. And that's it. Like, you know what could have been more engaging? Having Spyro in super stressful situations that can't be solved by any of his abilities, and he needs to remember one of the other ones. When Spyro relearns the electric breath, the Chronicler says this.
This power is accentuated by your impulsive nature.
Oh, stop.
There are so many other better and more symbolic ways Spyro can relearn these abilities. This is why Spyro learning the fire breath in A New Beginning was the only good one. His best friend was about to fucking die, and this was the only way to save him. So, I really think that the entire Sky Pirate level was pointless, and it just could have been taken out of the game completely. This is what I was talking about earlier with how this game could have just been DLC to A New Beginning. They could have completely removed the Sky Pirate level and put in a level where maybe you play as Cinder and she's trying to find her way somewhere, I don't know, when she is attacked by the apes and taken hostage. Because, like, again, like, we don't see how Cinder is captured by the Sky Pirates. She just happens to be there. And after defeating the Sky Pirate captain, when Spyro is flying towards the White Isle, he just so happens to fall unconscious and falls into the ocean. But then he just so happens to land on this thing, which, like, I cannot find anything anywhere that tells me what this thing even is. Anyway, this thing takes Spyro to the White Isle. What a coincidence. Literally, how did that happen? And it's like, he didn't even need the map then. What was the point of anything that just happened over the past 2 hours of that pirate level? Nothing. The climax battle against Gaul, the Ape King, feels like it comes completely out of nowhere. It doesn't even feel like a final battle. I mean, we don't even learn about him until Spyro makes it to the White Isle. Did we even stop the Eternal Knight? I don't think we did. I honestly don't know. I think the plan was to rescue Cinder, because they said if the Dark Master returns, then Cinder will just turn back into the giant evil dragon. And during the fight against Gaul, we see the moons align, and that's how we're able to become Dark Spyro and kill him. So I mean, I don't think we did stop it. This game ends so abruptly. Like I said, I played Dawn of the Dragon before. Okay, I don't know why I skipped Eternal Knight. Okay, I just did. Alright, I played this game when I was like 16. Okay, I was fucking retarded. So I knew that the trio ended up in a crystal. But just imagine playing this game for the first time. You finally defeat Gaul and turn back into normal Spyro. The ceiling crumbles and Spyro activates his Fury ability and puts everyone into a time crystal. And then the credits just start rolling. Within 3 minutes of defeating Gaul, the credits start rolling. We hardly get any closure. It just ends. Speaking of which, I thought it was a crystal that they were trapped in. But then I saw that Spyro puts them in the crystal through his Fury ability. So that made me think that it was actually ice, because Spyro actually does have an ice Fury attack. But no, it is a time crystal. Like, where the fuck did Spyro learn to make time crystals? Overall, the game is garbage. The gameplay still sucks, the characters still suck, and the story still sucks. But, unlike A New Beginning, there were a very small amount of things that I did like. And it was just enough for me to give The Legend of Spyro, The Eternal Knight, a 3 out of 10. It still sucks, but it's better than A New Beginning. All right. This is it. The big one is next. Dawn of the Dragon. Not only is it the last one in this trilogy, but it's the last one to save this trilogy. What am I saying? This trilogy cannot be saved, okay? Even if this one is good, it's still a 1 out of 3. I don't remember much about Dawn of the Dragon, but I can say that it is developed by a completely different studio. And that's important, because that means that the gameplay will be different. However, even though the gameplay might be better, the team of writers and the director are still the same. So the gameplay could be better, but the story could still be shit. So who knows what'll happen? How much of this game will I remember? Will I care? It is time to find out.